It's always an exciting time when you're booking a trip abroad for yourself and your mates, and we're all now going further afield trying to find them big and beautiful carp. Our latest adventure was at Lake Orellana in Spain, and it could not be easier to book. We booked through Angling Escapes, very simple, straight onto Google, anglingescapes.co.uk. The Angling Escapes website is very user friendly. You can click on destinations and it comes out of a little tab of all the different countries. Click on Spain, down to Extremadura, Carp, then you find Lake Orellana. Then you come down to a calendar for availability. It's got all the available dates or the ones that have already been taken, so it could not be simpler. The website is very helpful. It tells you all the information on the venue. The guide that we use, Edwin, gives you a nice breakdown of the do's and don'ts of the venue and all the add-ons that you can get in your package. You can actually get picked up from the airport, whether it be Sevilla or Madrid, or you can drive and survive just like we did. On the website, it also gives you information for boilie packages and particle, but the guide is absolutely crucial. You don't want to be going to a venue of this size, going in blind. Our guide, Edwin, was absolutely superior. Very, very helpful, very knowledgeable, and I must say, it's one of the greatest guides that we've had on any of the great escapes. There's a little insight in how to book Lake Orellana. As I said, it's very simple. Now all that's left to do is open yourself a nice cold beer, sit back and relax, and watch the latest instalment of The Great Escape.
Well, me and Rick, the cameraman, left early. We left at 3 o'clock. Dan and the lads reckon they were leaving about 4:30 or 5. And if you look at this, I'm just hoping that I don't have the whole lake to myself. Sat nav is showing 19:15. I have to be on that ferry by 8. Otherwise, it's Great Escape UK. It's not looking good. Someone. Car set on fire and they're resurfacing the M25 and they've shut it down to one lane. It's now, my sat nav is showing that we're going to get there at 19:51 and we've got to be there by 8. Well, don't ask me how, but we've got here at 19:32, and I wouldn't say it's strictly legal how we got here, but we turned the van into a time machine. But we're here.
Well, turn right onto George Bing Way, then turn right.
Well, that was close. We nearly missed a ferry. Great to catch up with the boys. We're going to be on here for 2 days. All we can now do is fill our bellies, drink beer, and talk carp. What a way to spend 48 hours.
Hey Dave, stop monkeying around.
Mate, they're making me do this. It fuels the engines. We've got to keep going. We'll be there soon. Come on.
So we just had dinner. How much longer have we got on this thing, Jay?
I think we've got about another 15 hours.
Oh my God.
It's a long, long ferry ride.
It is when it's COVID and nothing's open.
Nothing's open, there's no, you know, it's just boring, isn't it? But needs must. We can't grumble too much. No. We've got Spain to conquer.
Oh yeah.
So we're on the boat, we're just about to get off. Been on here 30 hours. Really, really smooth. Literally drove to Portsmouth, jumped on, couple of nights in the cabin. A few beers along the way with your mates. Really, really smooth trip over. Another 7 hours to the lake. Cannot wait to get there. Should be a good crack. It's busy, busy, busy at the moment. We're organising all of our kit. And on the road we will be soon enough. Catch you all in a bit.
I, for one, cannot wait to get off this boat, get on the travels. We're going to go and meet our guide today before we go and visit the venue tomorrow. And I really, really can't wait. This is one of those places that is on your bucket list that you want to fish when you've got the opportunity to go to certain countries in Europe. And this is one of them for me. Not going here thinking we're going to catch loads and loads of fish. It's going to be a challenge. It's a bit like an inland sea. Kilometres and kilometres of open water. Really nice mountainous backgrounds. And I, for one, cannot wait to put a rod in the water. Seriously, how did Jay get all his gear in there?
It's
Smell that, Max? Well, freedom.
Oh, I thought you farted again.
It doesn't always have to be about the fish. When you're traveling, you see some exquisite places, and Spain was no different. Absolutely beautiful scenery. And then it was time we set foot on the mighty Orellana.
We met up with our guide, Edwin, and his lovely wife, Rezi, where they cooked us an absolutely fantastic meal and told us about some of the mysteries that reside in the lake.
Edwin, thank you to you and your wife, welcoming us in with some lovely food and some beers. What a lovely place we've got behind us.
Yeah, no problem. We're happy to do this for you. How was the journey?
The drive was really smooth, lovely. The ferry was perfect, wasn't it? We got on literally 2 nights in the cabin, a few beers, some nice food, and it was just nice and easy. Nice. If I was going to be fishing in Spain again, I wouldn't drive through all of Europe to get to here. I would definitely go that way around.
It was a lot more relaxing, wasn't it?
Yeah. So whereabouts are we going to be starting off, do you think?
This is the bottom part of the lake, the deepest part. Yeah. On my right-hand side is the dam, and on the left-hand side you will have the Roman Bridge. This is the one-third bottom part. Right. And I will go up the down part in the big bay, underneath those mountains in the back, okay. Which I call the Big Fish Bay.
Oh, okay, it's, sounds it's, good.
It's an area where the big mirror lives. And when she comes out, and she doesn't come out often, but when she comes out, it's mostly in that area.
Okay.
So I thought that's
well,
a nice
gonna
challenge.
Well, I'm going to put my name on that one. Sorry, lads. I've already claimed that one.
I think that's a coin flip.
I've already claimed it. I've just said it on camera. So.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll fight for it. No, that.
That was a joke. Is this a big expanse of water? How many miles did you say it was earlier? Something like.
It's 30 miles. 30 miles long.
It's mental, isn't it?
Yeah. 30 miles is insane. Yeah.
And this area has deeps with an average of 20, 25 meters. When you have the middle part, you have an average depth of 15 meters. And the top part with the other bridge, the bridge of Casa Don Pedro, it has an average depth of 9 meters. So the more higher we go, the shallower it becomes, the warmer it is. But a lot of small fish now are all up the lake. So we try to get some bigger ones.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
I'll take a small one to start.
just a bite start would be good, wouldn't it?
A bite's the first aim for all of us, you know.
Yeah, it's a difficult period, I have to be honest. It's never been so long, so cold in January, February, as it has been this year. And weather is changing every couple of few days. Sunny, raining, sunny. But I have a feeling we will catch some fish.
Brilliant.
And we go for it.
All we can do is try.
Exactly.
Yeah, we go for it.
Right, so we're all full up. I think the best thing we could do is have a couple more beers, get the bed chairs out of the vans, because we're not going to fish tonight. We've had a long day, haven't we? And I think the best thing we can do is to start fresh. Nice and early.
Full up is an understatement.
Yeah,
the food you laid on for us and your wife, thanks. Yeah. It's been absolutely brilliant.
So cheers, mate.
Cheers. Good luck this week, lads.
Cheers to a good week, boys.
That first morning, I woke up with so much anticipation. I'd been looking forward to this for probably over 2 years. I'd been set the challenge by some Spanish anglers of one day fishing Orellana. Now that day was here and the challenge was accepted.
It's a big lake, 12,000 acres. I know that there are about 12 known 30 kilo plus fish. 85% of all the fish are commons. Big, long fighting machines, big tails. If you get a little bit more in the season, they get kind of orange because of all the crayfish that they eat. And there are some really beautiful, fully scaled creatures in. Yeah, really, really lovely.
How active are the crayfish at the moment?
At the moment, because of the cold, I haven't seen them.
It's at the moment possible to fish with boilies, to fish with tigers, to fish with everything. Yeah. If you are more in the season and the crays are more active, they even bite pieces out of your plastic mace. It's unbelievable.
Jay nearly lost a toe once, didn't you?
I did nearly lose a toe, yeah. Yeah, I've got a fear of crowfish now.
Thank you as well, Edwin, because I understand that you've sorted out our permits. We've got one for the boats, for permission to use the boats, and then one also for actually fishing. You organised them both for us.
Yep, I'm going to get them now, and then we can start.
Excellent.
Perfect.
Thank you, mate.
We find our way coming down to the water's edge, unloading the vans, getting the engines out, unrolling the boats, loading them up for our maiden voyage.
Just arrived at our starting point for the venue, and the fairest way, just drawn on a little piece of paper, left, middle and right. I've put them all in the RidgeMonkey cap. I'm not going to take one because I've written them out. The lads are going to choose one each and I'll be left with whatever's left. So one of you boys want to go first?
Go on, Jay.
Yeah. Let's see what we got. I am on the middle.
Middle for fiddles.
Do me.
You're an obed. What's that meant to mean?
Left. So I'm in the right hand side, I'm down in the little bay.
Yeah.
No cool. Worries, boys.
It's good to me.
Yep. Bring it on.
Yeah, good. That's all we can do, innit?
Yep, good right. To go.
So as you can see, I'm in the swim and it is treacherous. There are rocks everywhere, but I'm really happy with that. It's going to be a fun week. I know that for a fact. There's going to be laughs, there's going to be fun, and there's going to be loads of carp caught, I hope.
So when I got to the swim, the guide Edwin's took me out on the boat, showed me some of the areas that have been doing fish in the past. And I've got to say, some of them at 33 foot deep, I was a little bit, I don't know if that's the one at this time of year. But I'm told, even though it's 19, 20 degrees today, it is still winter in Spain and the fish still will be looking in that deep water.
This lake is packed with features in abundance. Big gravel bars, little silty depressions, there's clay hard spots, really nice clear, shallow margins. There is some weed, but the main thing, it's like bits of flint or bits of rock. They really are savage, very aggressive. So for that, I'm gonna tackle up with braid. So I'm gonna spool up shortly, some lead-free leaders and a very, very heavy leads. I wanna get in contact with the fish straight away. I really, really can't wait to get started. It's a beautiful place with beautiful surroundings and the fish are absolutely incredible.
So we are probably at one of the most beautiful lakes I've ever actually fished. It's stunning. I mean, there is rocky mountains. There is just, it's an amazing backdrop. I've got a sunrise to my right hand side, the sun sets to the left, and it's a joy to wake up in the morning too. So I'm looking forward to that.
All that leaves me to do now is go and get my kit set up. I'm gonna jump into the escape bivvy, tie some rigs. I've got a spool up because how aggressive. I'm gonna get the braid on straight away and then we can get some rods out.
My confidence is in the left-hand area where it's about 2 meters, 6 to 10 feet deep there. And I think that's where they're gonna be visiting. The sun's gonna be pounding onto that bank. So I'd never question Edwin. He's an absolute expert on this lake. So I'm gonna follow his guidance and let's see what happens.
So I'm just about to put the rods out. I'm going to talk you through the kit that I'm using. I've got a 12-foot Hyacinth Free Spirit rod in 3 1/4 test curve. Reason I'm using a soft rod on such a massive great big lake is I'm fishing descend braid all the way through. Now, that just gives me a little bit more cushion when I'm playing the fish, which is exactly what you need when you're fishing braid all the way through. I've got the braid on a Shimano CI4 reel, which is really deep spooled, so it's perfect. I can get the rods out at 400 yards, absolutely no dramas whatsoever. Coming down to the leader end, I've got 6 foot of 50-pound lead-free leader. Pins it to the bottom perfectly, so if anything's in the area grubbing about, it's just going to lay down. Also, if there's any snags in the area, this is bulletproof, so I won't have no worries about getting cut off. Nice and strong is exactly what you need. And then rolling down to our new uni lead clip. This is fantastic. I can drop the lead as and when I want it, or if I'm fishing somewhere where I don't want to drop the lead, just a quick spin and it locks in place. Absolutely perfect. Then as you can see, I've got a monster size lead. This is a 12-ounce gripper. Fishing at 400 yards, I need something nice and heavy, and that's going to pin it to the bottom and not move anywhere. And also, when the fish picks it up, it's going to nail it. And because I'm using the uni clip, it's going to come straight off. And I've got a short anti-tangle sleeve with a nice big loop underneath so I can quick change the rigs as and when I want. This is 9 inches of rock bottom, stiff coated. And the reason I'm using the stiffer one opposed to the softer one is I really do want this to kick away because I'm fishing in quite deep water. And it's a rig I've been playing with. This is the Slip D multi-rig. The reason I'm using something so simple is because I'm using a little wafter setup where the snowman will just literally go up and down the shank perfectly on the bottom. I don't want it to be up off the bottom like a pop-up. I want this to be sitting flat. This is a size 4 medium shank curve, and it's razor sharp. The Slip D multi-rig is a really simple rig. It's basically 2 inches of uncoated braid that I've made a loop into and then left the rest of it coated, so it kicks away perfectly from the lead and sits perfect every single time. So I think I'm going to put these back together, get out in the boat and get the rods in the water. So I'm just drifting up to the marker now. I've got my rotor block out there, absolutely perfect spot, just at the bottom of the slope, and that goes into about 10 metres of water. I'm fishing at about 7, and up here is about 5 metres, so it drops in nice and easy. I've got some lovely bait there that I did a bit earlier, but I'm also going to put a little bit more now and then drop a rig, and hopefully we can get a bite off of this spot because it's only about 70, 80 yards out, and absolutely perfect. So that's the rig dropped, get back to the swim. I'm going to try and get back pretty quick, and what I'll do is on the way back is I'll dip the tip just behind the boat so that it's sinking the line all the way back and trying to keep in a dead straight line. So off we go. So there we go, that's one rod done, two more to go.
So with everyone ready for the night, there was a lot of anticipation. How big would the first fish be? Would we even get a fish? Only time would tell.
Well, it's sometime in the early hours and we've been woken up by our first Orellana carp. And fingers crossed we get him in. He's a hell of a long way out. And don't feel too bad at the moment. Trying to concentrate on getting him in. And yeah, feeling quite nervous. It's taking forever to get in. I was fishing at about, I'd say 400 yards. And yeah, it's an arm-aching battle. It's hard to believe that there's 30 miles of water in front of us.
Note to self, always wear trousers to bed when filming.
What in?
Lift it up.
What in?
Yeah.
Get in there.
It's a 50, Dave.
Definitely at least 40, 50 deep.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Going to quickly get the rig out of the way. You can see the new lead clip has got rid of the lead. And one of the new beak point hooks. A tiger and a little rubber bait. I think she's a probably a mid 30, I think. They're deceiving, I think, these fish. 40 pound on the nose.
Yes.
Well, it's just coming up to 5 a.m. on our first night and I've caught myself a 40 pound common. I'm absolutely over the moon. This was my target for the entire week and this happened on the first night. So in a short time, when the sun comes up, we'll take a look at the golden prize I've got in that sack. I can't wait to show you. I'm absolutely buzzing. Stood here in my boxers, wet, and I'm over the moon. We heard about this lake 2 years ago at the Madrid show. People were telling us, if you want a challenge, this is where you need to come, and here we are. So my first fish caught him at about 450 yards, and my shoulders were burning getting this in. It seemed to take forever. Really scrapped hard. And to think there's a fish in here twice the size of this, it's actually quite frightening. But what an amazing creature. Well happy.
It's always nice to get your first fish from the water, especially one the size of Orellana. So with that fish under my belt and the pressure off, I shared the information with my mates, and me and Dan repositioned a couple of his rods in the same depth of water as I'd caught a carp from.
That's the spot, mate.
Yeah, that's on it, mate.
We're bait up, drop the rig.
4 metres there and you're in about six on the bottom of this shelf.
Yep.
You can see the bottom there, it just comes away lovely. No wonder they're patrolling up and down here.
So me and Dave have found a new spot, done a little bit of investigating with the Ray Marine. Some nice shallower areas, over 440 yards away. And I really think this one might do the business. It's over 400 yards out, so I'm keeping the braided main line under tension, just so the rig stays in position, because it's a long way back to shore. As I drop the rigs, Dave's baited up perfectly, nice and accurately, over the bait, to the left and to the right. So if they come in grazing, there's going to be some food there with a hook bait in the middle.
We are away. I am attached to my first Orellana carp. What a feeling. It's a privilege to be on such a great venue, 12,000 acres in the pitch black, treacherous ground, waders are on, and it just feels great. The power of this fish is unbelievable, stripping the braid off the reel. All that's left to do is coax him over the net. Take a look at my prize. Size would be absolutely irrelevant. It's just a joy to be off the mark on such an expanse of water. Get in there.
Well, I'm going to get this one now out into a bit of deeper water in the margin. Got an hour and a half till sunrise is coming up, and I cannot wait to see this in a couple of hours' time. Absolutely stoked to get my first one, and yeah, I'll be out of a nice cup of tea waiting for that sunrise in just under a couple of hours' time and be able to look at my first Spanish prize. Yes, made up with that one.
Ridiculous. Second night in, and I had two bites within no time at all. Completely separate rods, left rod, right rod. It just shows. Whoa. I feel absolutely every little lunge on the braided main line.
Well, we now have two in very quick succession on two rods nowhere near each other. So I do think there's a couple of fish at the back of this bay. I am super, super happy now.
Well, that woke me from a very deep sleep. And luckily Dan was on hand to put the shorts on for me. Just like leading a dog on a lead at this range. Great thing with this braid, we know that there's lots of rocks and jagged stuff in this lake. And you've got the confidence of knowing you've got that extra toughness. Well, there you go, that's the result of the take you just saw. Double figure common from 12,000 acres, I'll take that. Where you go, mate?
Thanks for the brew, mate. Come down to tell you my good news, and as I got in your swim, your middle rod's away.
Yeah. It's hard work reeling in for that range, isn't it?
Yeah, I've only got one rod at similar distance. It's over 400 yards. But the first 200 is just like crank.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
But it's just really nice to get off the mark, mate.
It's a bit chillier today.
But yeah, temperatures have dropped.
And it seems all the action is happening at night anyway.
Yeah, we said 40 would be like a milestone. All we need now is one of them elusive mirrors, and it's the makings of a really good session, this.
I think they're a bit rare, aren't they, the mirrors?
They really are.
See what happens, mate. I think there's going to be another big one on the cards.
I really do as well.
Anyway, you've got two waiting up there, haven't you?
Should we go and have a look?
Let's go and have a look. Come on.
Well, there we go. There's my first one to show you from this stunning lake here in Spain. Mid-double common, real hard-fighting fish. And this was the second of this morning's action. Got a bigger one to show you, just under 26 pounds. I'm going to slip this lively character back into the water now and get that really nice common out.
It's always such an exhilarating feeling when you get your first one from a new venue, especially in beautiful surroundings like we've got here in Spain. This is the first one for me, just under £26, hard fighting Spanish common, and I am absolutely made up. I love spending time with these boys, catching amazing carp like this, and visiting amazing venues all over Europe. Bait choice for me is very simple, but for a lot of people, they can get caught up in it, it can be very confusing, and they end up taking lots of things that they're not going to need. Whether you're fishing in England or Spain, 2 acres or 12,000 acres like I'm faced with here, such a great bit of water. What you want to use is something that you're confident in, but also in conjunction with what the locals are using. Here is a little bit of a mix of what I'm using. Majority of this mix in, 90% of it is what the locals use. The guide gave this to us when we arrived and we've been getting drums of this. It's maize, tigers and hemp. The carp see this all the time when the local Spanish lads are putting this in. They see it in abundance, they're coming to it and they will eat it.
As always, I add a bit of Himalayan rock salt to that. I just love the stuff, I think it's perfect. They haven't all spawned in here yet. Also, by adding the salt, it makes the mix PVA friendly. So if I want to put a big bag of mixed particle out there, I actually can. I can just hook it on and lower it down, no dramas without it melting the PVA. So it's a bit of an added bonus.
Okay, I'm going to talk to you about what's been successful for me during this session, the application of the bait and what I'm adding to it to make it so attractive. So firstly, let's look at the boilies. A lot of people talk to me about the bait I use when I'm abroad, how they can freeze it and preserve it. I don't bother with that anymore. In the past I have, but I'm so confident now in this high impact range, I literally just bring shelf life bait and I use that.
I'm using the preserved bait, which means I can bring it for a week, 2 weeks. I don't have to worry about it going off or putting it in the freezer. It's ready to go straight out of the bag, which is absolutely perfect for me. It's exactly what I like. Onto the boilies. I wasn't too sure whether we'd be using a lot of boilie out here this week due to the crayfish, but we have experimented and the crays don't seem to be very busy, which is great, which means I can get the boilies in. I do like fishing with boilies over particle. So in reality, when I'm fishing, I'm gonna be putting a lot more boilie out than I am the particle. A couple of scoops of particle over maybe 5 or 6 scoops of boilie. I'm actually using 15 and 18 mil boilies in the Bug from DNA. It's a new bait. I normally use the S7, but I've been testing this and it's been doing really, really well. So I thought I'd bring it along on this trip.
I've been using the Salty Squid, Choco, High Impact Pineapple, and also the Banoffee. Got a lot of confidence in all of these. But the reason I wanted a different mixture of colours is prior to coming to the lake, I didn't know if the water was gin clear, murky. So I wanted to allow for everything. So the way I've been applying this bait is mixing it up different colours so the bottom is lighting up in different light levels. And I've also been adding some liquids. I've been using the IB liquid, simply squirting it in over the boilies and giving them a good mix up.
I'm also using some baits from the mainline stable. These ones are the Banoffee. These are 20 mil shelf life, high impacts. What I've done a little bit different to Dave, I've added some lake water, I've got the stick mix liquid in the matching flavour, the Banoffee, and I've just put a nice helping in there. I leave these for 24 hours before I'm going to use them, just so they're soaking in. What it means, they go a bit of a washed out colour. I know using washed out baits, the fish come in, they're nice and soft, they pass through them quickly and they continue to come back looking for more.
Now I know there's a lot of crayfish in this lake, so what I wanted to do is put something out that if the crayfish were very active, luckily they've not been, there was something still there when the carp moved into the area. So I've been using the black and white tigers from the particle range. This again, I've got two different colours there, sending up different sight signals. But what I've just been adding to these to make them a little bit more attractive is the Foss oil. Oil is always an excellent thing to put on your bait because it comes up into the water column and any fish moving along, particularly in deep water like this, we're fishing between 6 and 10 metres, the oil is filling the column and the fish is literally hitting a wall of smell and it's attracting it down to the bottom. And the great thing with tiger nuts is they make a crunch. As the fish are chucking them back, they're crunching away, and I totally believe that the other fish hear that and it attracts them into the area.
With the tigers, I'm doing exactly the same. I've got some tigers from one of my good friends back at home, Dan Kilgore. He's done me some jumbo XLs. These are full of crunch, loads of attraction. They've got loads of pulling power. These ones have been soaking in Red Bull for quite a while and they're full of flavour. You could eat them yourself. They're absolutely lovely.
There's a reason I like to use yellow baits in my broad, and that's because a lot of the lakes get fed a lot of maize. So that is a food signal colour. When the fish see it, they relate it to food. So I always add yellow baits to my mix. And obviously when they come down and they're eating that boilie, there's a lot more taste and flavour than a bit of maize. And hopefully that'll keep them in the area. I do like to add other baits. This is the Choco, something I do really well on. Smells absolutely lovely. I like to give them a good mix. There's nothing wrong with having a mix of bait thrown into there.
I've crushed up a load of it. Went through the crusher twice. It's real, real fine. So what I'm gonna do with that, I've mixed it up with a load of the liquid food, poured that over the boilie, and the end result is a powdered boilie that gets to the bottom perfectly. Any fish come along, we've got loads and loads of fine ingredients that powder up and cloud all the area up. Also loads of smell in the water, and absolutely bang on.
So that is my bait application. Hook bait wise, I'm using a tiger nut with a little rubber boilie on top of it. I'm doing that so if the crayfish are really active and I've got to leave my rods out for 24, 48 hours, I've got the confidence to know I've still got a hook bait on.
These giant tigers added with a pop-up counterbalance the weight of the hook absolutely perfectly. The hook lays flat on the lake bed and yeah, it's been working wonders. I've had some really nice fish on this mix. And as I said, you've got to be confident in the mixes that you're using, whether you're fishing 2 acres, 20 acres, anywhere in Europe. Bait and bait application is a real key factor for fishing. If you're not confident in your bait, you're always going to be doubting yourself, and that never happens to me with the bait choices that I use.
Yeah, this one is probably off my marker pole. I'm about 15, 20 foot back. That way, if I catch a fish and it makes the marker pole, even if it goes round it, the marker pole's designed to just flop down and pop back up, so there's no problem. But what I'm gonna do, my right hand rod, I see a fish show this morning when I'm sitting here with Rick. It was a good fish. So I'm gonna go out there in the boat, find that area. I'm gonna drop a bait down and then just bring that straight back. So a few reasons I love to use braided mainline. Zero stretch gives you good bite indication. It's super tough, abrasion on anything like the rocks and the mussels that are in this lake. I'm really good in weedy situations. When I'm fishing at such range, at the moment we're fishing over 400 yards out, bite indication is everything. If I had a mono out there, the fish could probably move 10 or 12 feet before I even knew what was going on. But with the braid, it's almost an instant indication. And you can feel everything the fish does. It's definitely my favourite line for fishing. This particular braid I'm using is the new RidgeMonkey braid, Descend. And it's a nice olive green. Sinks absolutely brilliant. And I do believe this one I'm using on this particular trip is a 30 pound version. But there will be other versions coming out. I'm just pulling myself out to the spot, which is at 400 yards. On the end of here, I've got a 10 ounce lead with a tiger nut on a blowback rig. We'll have a little look at that when we get out there. And I'm just gonna drop it a little closer to this bank. So I've had this rod out a few days and it hasn't moved. I'm gonna reposition it. And the bites I've been getting have been on maize, hemp, and tigers. And obviously I had a 40 pounder. Other than that, I've had a tiny little one and Dan's had two quite small ones for this lake, both on hemp and tigers. So I'm gonna have a little tactical change. I'm still gonna keep the tiger nut hook bait on so the crays can't get it off. But what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna drop about a kilo and a half of boilies over the top of it and then spread some particles in the area. I'm hoping that the boilies are gonna bring me a bigger fish. Right, let's get this rod in.
So with the rods out for the night and a tactical change in place, let's see what the night would bring.
Well, that was an absolute one-toner, and it stripped line off me from the start. Quite a strong fish. It's hard to tell really how big they are because they're at such range. But it is definitely an arm-aching battle just due to the range. But this one feels a lot bigger than that last one this morning. I'm going to put my head torch on. Some sharp rocks down to my left, so it's important that I keep this fish in front of me to avoid getting cut off on them. As I mentioned earlier, when I was in the boat today, I was going to do a little change up, come away from the particle, put more boilies in. So I went out there, dropped a load of Bonoffi boilies out around the bait, hoping it would bring a bigger fish. And at the moment, it seems to be working. Due to the zero stretch on this braid, you can feel every twist, turn, head kick. And it is quite intense, but I've got to say I like it. You feel in complete control all the time, which is what I want from a mainline. I must have got 300 yards of braid back now. And the old back is aching. It's coming in like a dog on the lead at the moment. But I know when it gets to this margin shelf, it's going to kick off a little bit.
To the left, yeah. I could hear a load of commotion going down to my left-hand side, so I thought I'd go and see what was going on. And there Dave was, yeah, line strips off of his reel. I think he was connected to an absolute monster, so I thought I'd go and give him a hand. Well, this is absolutely pulling your arm off, mate.
Right.
This is a fight and a half. Madness. It just goes to show you, these big wild fish in here, mirrors, commons, you know they're going to pull your arm off, so that's why the gear's set up nice and strong for it.
Yeah, exactly, mate, yeah. When this thing turns and goes on runs, it's like an absolute steam train. I'll bring her in low. Stretch that net out full, Jeff.
I will be right. Yes, mate.
That? Mate.
That is a chunk.
Well, that fish just beat the hell out of me, literally. My legs are shaking, my wrist is aching. I think I need a cup of tea.
That's an absolute beast.
Yeah.
Proper nice on that.
Is it?
Yeah.
Make that beer.
Definitely a beer.
Cheers, mate. Let's get that thing sorted for us. £42.
Really?
Yeah. £42.
Wow, I thought she was bigger than that.
Yeah.
Well done, mate. What an absolute beast.
Yeah. Thanks, mate. Cheer
up.
I love you too.
Well done, mate.
Thank you, mate. Well, there you go. And that is an absolute fighting machine. And you only have to look at the size of this tail to know this carp spends a lot of time swimming up and down the 30 miles of water that it lives in.
and I will say it's an absolute privilege to catch it.
His rod went 24 hours ago. Similar time, so it's clear to see that even on a huge, huge lake like this, there's a little bit of a pattern forming. I'm not saying it's going to continue in any way, but while it is happening, I've got to make the most of it. Get in there. Well, that was absolutely ridiculous. Over one line, under again, out in the lake, sorting it out. So pleased now. They visited that spot two nights running, and I cannot wait to have a look at this one. Really, really pleased. The mix of the maize, the hemp, the tigers, and the banoffee boilies is working a wonder. And yeah, I'm really, really looking forward to seeing this one. It's a little bit bigger than the others, and chuffed is an understatement.
Well, I've just had a bit of a slow take, and to be fair, the cameraman was going to get up, and I said, don't bother, it's only a little one. Played it all the way in, and it suddenly grew as it got to the margin. Put up a really good scrap under the rod tip. The governor's just netted it, and he said it could be the biggest fish yet. So we'd get her out, weigh her, put her in the sling and have a look when it's light. Pardon me.
Yeah, go on, mate.
48.
With a lovely 48-pound common safely waiting for photos, the night wasn't over yet.
Well, my third bite of the night, again on them long rods. And again over boilie, so the boilie seems to have done the trick. My shoulder is killing. I feel like I've been in the gym. Three of these in a night from over 400 yards of fish. Starting to feel it in my wrist and my shoulder. I'm not complaining, it's a good pain. I'm shining my head torch about and hoping to catch a glimpse of a carp on the surface. It's just pitch black out there still. When we left England, it was getting light at 6 a.m. In Spain, it's not getting light till around 7 o'clock. Well, that's the third fish of the night. Really, really pleased that them tactics of putting the boilies in have paid off, and it's definitely worked. Three fish, two over 40 pound, a 48 pounder sitting in the sling waiting for a bit of daylight, and what looks like a 30 set in the net. I tell you what, I couldn't be happier at the moment.
Well, it was a long time coming and I finally got that bite,
and playing the fish in the middle of the night. I was absolutely bricking it, but I was so excited at the same time. I couldn't tell whether it was a big fish or small fish. I literally did not care. They've come along to help me out. I was very, very excited by this one and I couldn't wait to get it in the net. And when it went in, I was absolutely buzzing.
Yes. She's certainly not a monster, but she's my first ever Orellana carp. Absolutely buzzing with this one.
30 miles of water.
Wicked.
So, middle rod's gone. First time this rod's gone. This rod's been out there getting on for 48 hours now. I've just left this one while I've redone the other two around it. So it's on a nice zone, nice area. And if this goes, it'll mean all three rods have gone. Dave's had another 40 pound common. Absolutely amazing result. We wanted a 40 pounder for this venue. And the general's done what the general does. 2 40 pounders in the opening 3 nights on a lake of this size is no mean feat. And I wouldn't be surprised if he has another bite. The early hours of this morning, just like Jay, they both had bites quite early on in the morning. But to come somewhere just this sheer size and get the number of bites that we've had. But what I will say is, these could be my first 4 bites, and then they could also be my last 4. It can change just like that on a venue this size. They move out, and you've got to go chasing them. And when the lake is such a vast amount of water, the size it is and the depth that this place goes down to, you might not be able to get back on them. So while I'm enjoying this fight and the start to this trip, long may it continue. Number 4. Can't believe it. I didn't expect it to be starting like this. Absolutely made up, but as I've touched on before, they can be your first few bites and they can be your last few bites just as quick as that. But I've just heard some incredible news that not only has Dave got another 42 down there, he has got a 48 pounder as well. So I'm gonna sort these fish out and I'm certainly gonna go and have a look at them.
Well, this was the smallest of 3 last night, but by no stretch the worst. Look at him, absolutely beautiful and all fighting hard. And at 400 yards, I can tell you my wrists and shoulders are absolutely killing playing them in, but boy, is it worth it. We're still quite early in the session. I've heard Dan's got a couple up there as well, and we was not expecting this at this place, I tell you. So God knows what's going to happen. I've been waiting maybe 2-3 years to come and see this venue, dreaming about it, and it's now become a reality. And I can't quite believe how this week's going. I'm absolutely blown away. I've got nothing to say. Just amazing. Well, look at that. What a place. What a fish. Stuff of dreams.
Well, my first Spanish 30. Just over 30 pound 2 ounces, hard fighting common. And this is the bigger of another two bites this morning. This place is absolutely mesmerizing. It's blown me away. Didn't expect to have so many fish. I don't think we're finished yet. This place has got a lot to offer, but you're gonna make hay while the sun shines, and I'm certainly enjoying it at the moment. Let's get one back down into his lovely habitat. And let me show you the smaller one. There you go, another fine common from Orellana. The last two mornings have both produced two fish. This one just over 20 pounds. We're getting a nice run of commons. Let's see if one of us can try and find one of those very elusive mirrors. Gonna get this one back now, get the rod back out, and enjoy some breakfast.
What a way to start my day. Beautiful common, fought like stink, at about 350 metres out, I reckon. Caught on a little multi-rig slip D that I've been playing around with, and a couple of bits of yellow fake corn. Over the moon, I couldn't be any happier with this one. Well, another absolute scorcher of a day, but I've caught a fish, so I'm over the moon today. Nice 25 pound common, so I've kind of ticked off what I wanted to catch from Orellana. David, an absolute banger, gorgeous carp. And yeah, early this morning, mine ramped off, fought really hard, long range rod, probably fishing at about 300 yards, maybe a little bit more. And yeah, over the moon, and hopefully we all catch a few more throughout the week. It'd be nice if we could stay here. So we'll get on with that and go from there.
Do not drop that tank.
That won't drop.
I cannot back it up in fear. When in Rome.
Go,
boys!
Thank Orellana. It's bloody freezing. Can't beat this.
Oh, oh, it's the life.
All I need here is my laptop.
When you come to a challenging and testing venue, just like we're faced here at Orellana, you have to use tried, tested, and rigs that you've got maximum confidence in. Just like what I'm going to show you, my medium curve D rig. I've used this as a Zaki, where the substrate is rocky. I've used it as Zumba, which has housed a very large fish. And what we're faced with here, there's lots of bars out there, lots of rockery, some really sharp substrate. So I'm using really strong braided mainline. When I come down to the rig end, I want to use components that I know are super strong and really reliable. That's why I choose to use them at the connection stable. I'm going to talk you through my rig now. Very, very simple. It's a size 4 medium curve. On the back of the medium curve, I've got a supple D section, but the coating has remained on this. So it's not really soft and supple, but it's got lots of movement, lots of freedom. And the hook link that I'm using here, this is the rock bottom soft 25 pound green. As you can see, it's really aggressive. It will turn every time you do a palm test. I've probably got 8-9 inches out there just to sit over the substrate nicely. And to go with that, I've got a rock bottom anti-tangle sleeve just to help aid on kicking it away when I'm lowering the rig from the boat. Hook bait of choice, really simple. I've got a Big Dogs XL Tiger. These are actually called Darth Vaders because they're pitch black. And on top there, I've got a mainline pineapple juice pop-up which means it's very slow sinking. The hooker lay flat on the floor with the hook bait just wafting up and down on the D section. And as I said, it's very reliable. Got maximum confidence in it. I've had some very large fish at other venues. The other reason why I'm using this rig here, a lot of the people that fish it locally, the Spaniards, what they like to do, they like to fish big beds of maize, hemp. What that means is the fish will be really grubbing down on the bottom. They're not using pop-ups over this, so the fish are used to coming in between the rocks, in the clay, and in the gravel areas looking for food. This will present itself absolutely perfectly. As long as I find a clear spot, which I have done out in the boat with a lead and the H-block markers, I know I'm going to be fishing effectively for the duration of my stay, and I know when I get that all-important bite, this rig will not let me down.
Well, all the camera lads have gone back to charge their gear, and we've got our first daytime bite. Typical. Carp must have known. I dropped that out about an hour ago with just boilie over it. And it feels heavy.
Is the Orksy fella?
And a savage trailer earlier.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't a fish, it was a trailer.
Go on, boy. This was one me and you played then.
The long one?
Yeah.
It looks such a good spot.
Yeah, six metres, I think.
It looks such a good spot when he's out there.
On, Davy boy.
Okay. Back is killing.
Cheers, mate. Yeah, man. Beautiful.
Another 40.
Is it?
Ah,
flop it.
Well, there she is, and the camera crew are back. 37 pounds of Lake Orellana Common. And check out the massive eyes. Great big rubber lips that you know she's grabbing them crayfish with, and them eyes will be helping her in this absolutely gin clear water. Magnificent carp. Things couldn't be going better for us lot at the moment. Happy days. Okay, darling, let's get you back.
And incredibly, the action didn't stop there.
Second bite of today, so I've had two daylight bites today, both on the same rod in open water on a sort of 6 meters. There's a slight shelf coming up out of 11 meters and it goes all the way up to 3 very gradually, and I'm fishing in 6 meters. That's where all my bites are coming from at the moment. It's quite easy to find on the echo sounder. I'm literally driving across to about 450 yards, turning the boat around, coming back at myself, and as the echo sounder shows 6 meters, I dropped the rod straight off the back of the boat. The only difference I've been doing is I've been putting quite a lot of boilie in, which I'm told is not the dumb thing on here. It's normally particles due to the crayfish, but because the crayfish have been inactive, I've been putting the boilies in and it seems to be working. But it don't seem to be working, it's definitely working. Now it's just the task of getting the fish back in from 450 yards.
I've been carp fishing 35 years and never had enjoyed a trip so much. Watching them big commons come up through that gin clear water, narrowly missing slate and big rocks, the tackle was really put to the test. It was such an excellent venue and a beautiful place to catch carp. We really were making some memories.
Looks a nice one, mate.
Cheers.
The hole is smashing it.
He's absolutely hauling them.
Cheers, boss.
Well done, mate.
It's going good.
Over that's the boilies, a nice one, isn't it?
Over the boilies again.
That's a lump, isn't it?
Yeah. That's a good one, that, look at it.
Good fish, yeah.
Oh, it's got some depth to it, yeah. Nice.
Check out the massive pecs on this fish. No wonder it put up such a scrap. And they're all different shapes and sizes. This one's got a big drop gut at the back of it. They spawned a couple of weeks ago in here, so no doubt this fish was a lot bigger a few weeks back, but you won't find me complaining. The fifth 40 so far, and I cannot believe how this trip is going. Anyway, we're losing the light, so I'm gonna get her back now. Quickly get that rod back out. 12,000 acres. Who knows when she'll get seen again.
With Orellana being such a massive, vast bit of water, you never knew an carp could leave the bay we were fishing, so I had to work hard while we're there to catch as many fish as we possibly could before a wind come along and changed the fishing.
It's crazy to think at the start of this week, our aim was to catch five fish between the group in a long session, with one of them being a 40 pounder. And we've had that in the last 24 hours. And that's how it's done in the War of the Flies. Check that out, probably a mid to upper 20. Absolutely beautiful, spotless common. I'm not going to mess him about. I can get him straight back and hopefully try and get some sleep.
Once again, I was stood in my boxer shorts. Different colour this time, so at least you know Levy changes his pants.
So a little while ago, while it was pouring down, I didn't get the camera in up because didn't really want to get their equipment out in that pouring rain. I was playing the fish in like I am this one. And you remember we said that it was 1 in 5 to 700 fish is a mirror, and up pops a mirror. When your luck's in, it's in, isn't it? A lovely 33-pound mirror. I've put him down there in the retainer. And believe it or not, it's actually about 6 o'clock in the morning and it's still pitch black. When it gets light, we'll get him out and have a look.
I actually couldn't believe my eyes when yet another mirror carp rolled on the surface in the torchlight.
Don't believe it. We not only just caught one mirror, we just caught two in a row. That's unbelievable. 1 in 5 to 700 fish is a mirror, and I've just had two back to back. That is absolutely mental. And they say lightning don't strike twice, but not only did I get one mirror, the very next bite was a mirror as well. And without being insulting to this poor old girl, she's a lot better looking. So I can see this fish has lost a few scales through spawning, and we want them to go back to see another day, so I've got the Pro Care out, and the properties of this mean that it's going to stay on the fish for well over 24 hours and help it with its healing. So I literally use my sleeve. I dry a little bit where the cut is, and you simply squeeze it over, put plenty on, be generous with it, they can go back. It's even got a bit of a sore tail on it, this one. Say the underneath in here is full of mussels and all sorts. A little treat on the hook hold, because the Pro Care is the only ointment on the market at the moment that you can use in the mouth and on the body. And you can see that has set almost like a scab over the sores, and that will stay there 24, 48 hours, medicating the fish, helping it heal. Absolutely brilliant stuff. Everyone should have this in their kit if you love carp. Well, there you have it, a very rare Orellana mirror, and what a fish. Her scales were as undulating and spiky as the rocks she lives in, but what an amazing creature. Again, that big rubbery mouth which I use for eating the crayfish and feeding on that hard bottom. Was not expecting to get one of these this week, and it really is turning out to be the session of my dreams. Orellana was actually on my bucket list of lakes to go to. So to do so well means so much. Just to show you how beautiful this mirror is, we'll spin around and have a look at the other side. Look at them different shaped scales, from little pinprick scales to plates. What an amazing carp. So from being told we'd be very, very lucky to get a mirror, I've had two back to back. So when I get home, I'm doing the lottery. Well, check her out. Definitely one of the prettiest carp I've ever caught from the biggest lake I've ever fished. Let's have a look at the rig I've been using throughout this session. It's already landed me quite a few fish. Obviously everything is a little bit stepped up because of where we're fishing, so I'll talk about the components as we go along. I'm using the Camo X hook link. It's a soft coated material that comes in a nice camouflage colour all the way through, greens, browns, so it blends in lovely with the bottom. So I cut about 20 inches of that off. It gives me plenty of room to work with. Then I'm simply going to strip back about 4 or 5 inches, that's going to allow me to do a knotless knot, just like that. Then in the end of there, I'm just going to put a straight forward overhand knot to make the hair. Pull the knot tight, you can just use the hook on your pulling tool. Nice tight knot. Just trim off the excess there, so it's a straight forward loop. Then I'm going to be using the Apex snag hook. This is the same pattern as a beak point, but it's just stepped up, a much thicker wire for dealing with much more strenuous situations like river fishing, big reservoirs, snags, weedy lakes, things like that. They're all stored separately so the tips stay nice and sharp. So it's simply through the back of the eye, pull it up, give yourself plenty of room. I'm using quite long hairs in this lake. The fish in here have got massive mouths, and I'm not going to go mad. I'm going to put about 5 turns, always making sure you go away from the forge of the hook. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then back through the back of the eye of the hook. There you go. So that's your knotless knot. Now I'm going to add the shrink tubing. So I've gone for a bit of green or brown, it don't matter, because you've got both colours running throughout that hook link. So I'll snip the shrink tube, thread that onto the rig. You might want to wet the top of the hook. That'll assist it in sliding over the eye, and that's going to run down to the shank of the hook. My second bit is going to be longer, probably about 10 to 15 mil. Snip that off, again, run that down the rig. Little bit of spit on the eye of the hook, and it'll just go over nicely, and we'll shrink that at the end. So there's your two bits of shrink tube. The reason I'm using shrink tube on the shank is, unlike a ring, that shrink tube will stay tight and in place until the rig has picked up. And because there's lots of crayfish in here, I don't want my rig getting messed around with, and I know it's going to stay set until the carp picks it up. Next, I'm going to add my anti-tangle sleeve. And on here, because I'm using very big leads, I'm using the long anti-tangle sleeve, so it adds just a little bit more protection to the hook link as it comes down in the water. On goes the anti-tangle sleeve, and I'm going to measure that out to about 12 inches, which might seem a bit long, but because we're fishing on rocks and undulating bottom, if my lead was to drop over a rock, I've still got plenty of hook link. That means it's exposed so it can catch a fish. So on this end, I'm just going to do a figure of 8 knot, which is dead simple. Just double it over, give it a twist and back through. And a little bit of spit on that, and just use your multi-tool to bed that knot in. Snip off any excess, then slide your anti-tangle sleeve up, and that's ready to go onto your quick change swivel. Now what I'm going to do, I'm just going to put this over the steamer, shrink this shrink tube down, and you'll see this is a very neat but simple rig that's mega effective. So that's my hook link from top to bottom. Let's have a quick look at what I'm attaching it to and how simple I've made it for you. So the leader material I'm using here is the Sub-Zero in 50 pound, and it is camouflage. This has got a lovely fleck in it that absolutely disappears in the water, blending into any bottom. So for this, I take off a good arm's length, which is probably about 4.5-5 foot, snip it off, then take your uni clip. I've really put this uni clip through its paces in the last couple of years. I've tested it in all sorts of environments, but particularly at this one where you've got all the rocks and snags, you want the lead to be gone straight away. This will guarantee that lead is gone. Now the great thing about our new lead free is you don't need to splice it, you can tie it. And I'm going to show you exactly how you do that. So I just use a baiting needle, put it through the uni clip, got a latch needle there, pull it through the centre, like so. Then you take the internals of the uni clip, which you can see there, you can add different swivels. I've got a quick change swivel on this one. You go through the top eye, and on this, I'm going to do a 5-turn blood knot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You might want to do a palomar or something like that. I'm quite happy to do a blood knot because this does not slip. Plenty of spit on it, pull it down, and then be extra safe. Get your multi-tool and give it a good pull. Pull it in every direction. Once you've done that, snip it off, giving it a slight tail. And if you really want to, for extra safety, you can blob that. I'm quite happy of how that is. Slide uni clip down, add your swivel, then and pick the side that you want. You can either choose to drop your lead with a lot of force or for it to come off very easy. In this situation, I want it to come off very easy. So I'm going to pull the clip onto the internals, and you'll see the swivel just sits snug in the end and very neat. So if we go to the other end of our leadless leader, you'll see that I'm not going to splice this either. I'm going to show you a very simple knot where you can join this to your monofilament or your braided mainline. And it's called the needle knot. You simply take a standard needle, the end of your mainline, thread it through the eye of the needle, take the end of your leader, and then you run the needle down the center of the leadless leader. So you run the needle through the center of the leadless leader, like so, and then simply pull your main line through. Once that's done, you can take the needle out of the way, and you'll see you've got your main line coming out the side of the leadless leader. Simply hold it so you can have an opening, and you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, back up and through the loop. Then put plenty of spit on
and just slide it up under control, pulling both tails at the same time, and it makes a lovely clean knot around the leadless leader. Then you simply just snip off the excess, and you can see just how neat that knot is. You're not losing any strength. If not, it's even stronger. I use this myself all the time. Just clip it onto the clip change swivel. Little bit of lubricant, slide that down. And I can obviously add what size lead I want to that. In this case, I'm using a 10 ounce lead, and that's gonna sit just so on the bottom. That's a really beautiful, neat rig that steps up for super strength, and one that has never let me down.
Unbelievably, the bites just kept coming, but one of these turned out to be extra special.
Look at that long, lean fighting machine. And this was the first of two bites last night. I actually had three bites, but unfortunately got cut off on the rocks. They're absolutely savage here. It was the first one I landed, 35 pound common, and things could not be going better. Down there in the retainer, I've got something really special. I'm so pleased with how it's going. This carp is absolutely beautiful. Lake Orellana is amazing. And so are its fish.
Well, look at that. 40 pound mirror from Orellana. I'll take that all day long. We was told that it was one in 500 fish would be a mirror. And this is my third one in four fish. I really don't know what the fuss is all about. Massive tail, big old barbs, rubbery mouths. Touch wood, I'm not getting many hook pulls on here. And I have stepped it up to a double X hook with a stronger wire, because pulling these fish in from that range puts a lot of stress on your average hook. What an incredible carp.
Well, check that out. Every mirror you catch from here is an absolute stunner. This one included. Size of the tail. She wants to go home, and I want to put her there. See you later.
It has been said in the past that I kiss my fish too much. They just don't seem to mind.
Well, I'm gonna make a move. I said right at the very start, if I get 48 hours without a bite, then I'll be on my toes. That's happened now. I've gone two nights without a bite, and I've actually had some local anglers turn up to the right of me, and I feel a little bit penned in this bay now. Even though the lake is so large in size, having some anglers there, angling pressure, additional lines can move the fish around. And without going for a bite for the first 24 hours, now going into 48 hours, I've made the decision, I'm gonna move. The lads have said they've seen some fish round the corner to where Davey's on the left. I'm quite a way round, a fair few hundred yards, but I'm not going to hesitate. I'm going to pack up before the rain comes. I'm going to get going, bivvy down bed chair, and I'm making my way there now.
that's the move all complete. Last thing was to find the spots, put three rods in the new areas, few scoops of bait, and now the waiting game happens again. It can be a lot of aggro moving, whether you're at home or abroad, but with the help of the guide that we've got, Edwin, one quick phone call saying that we want to move, go into a new area. He's thrown all my kit into his large boat, set me up on a new area, a bit more angling pressure. Now it's the weekend, but on somewhere this size, it's just absolutely lovely being here with rods out. What Dave has achieved in such a short space of time can only be described as a dream session, and it isn't over. Me and Jay were doing all we can to chip in with a few more fish, a few more bites, and now that I've moved into this new area, I feel really confident. I was getting penned in a little bit this morning, some Spanish anglers turned up to my right, put a rig not too far away from where one of mine was, so I just wasn't confident in that area anymore. Edwin's moved me to a new zone, new lease of life, full of confidence, the rods are out, let's go get that kettle on, and fingers crossed the new swim can do me an absolute whacker.
So for this trip, I'm using these Bonoffi shelf life baits from Mainline. I'm always getting lots of messages, people say, how do I store my bait, how do I keep it frozen? I don't bother, I just get the shelf life from Mainline. I prefer the Bonoffi, I seem to do really well on that. And I bring it on these trips because I know even if I don't use it, I can then just take it back home, but I cannot actually fault these shelf lives. What I'd like to do with this hook bait is just add some foam. Simply just lick one side, lay your hook in it, lick the other bit, push them together, and that's now going to come down. If there's any small bits of sediment, lead's going to hit the bottom, the foam's going to melt and slowly drop that bait on top of the weed and sediment, so it's nice and visible for the carp to see. I've got a plastic bait on the top and a tiger nut. Start sprinkling a bit of bait around here. I'm just chucking it all over the place. Literally in this area, it's not accurate baiting. Back. I'm going to go upwind a little bit so I get the bow out on my line, and it's as simple as that, no fuss.
When you fish at home, if you really feel you're not on them and the opportunities aren't going to arise, you have to get on your toes and get moving. Levy's in behind me.
I was just walking down because I could see Dan's head torch on, and I thought his move's paid off and he's got one on. I was literally about 20 yards from my rods, and the middle rod has gone into meltdown. I literally thought he was going to empty my spool. And I've got one as well. So Dan's over there playing one. I'm down here playing one. Just goes to show you, there is such a thing as feeding times.
What that guy has accomplished this week in 5 days is nothing short of extraordinary on such a testing venue. This is my long rod out of the three in this swim. Good 380, 400 yards. And it's still putting up into the count of myself. You think it'd be tired playing it from the bank. It's still taking line when it wants to. But it just feels really nice to be attached to another one. And as I say, especially after a move, you're putting all that effort moving.
careful. Can't believe how kind the lake's being to us. Thought we?
Maybe. 40.
That was the shout I needed. David got his in the net. Now it was my turn. New swim, a new area, and what a result. Yes!
It's really hard sitting behind motionless rods when your gut feeling really tells you that you've got to get moving. And I did that this morning, and into the new swim, and I've got one. Doesn't look like it's going to break any Spanish records, but it's made me really happy. After 2 nights without a fish, to now get one from another swim, it just proves that the bait, the tactics, and the bait application is working. If you're on the fish, you're going to catch them.
Well, that rod absolutely ramped off, and I only had about 30 yards of braid left on there, and I picked it up and it was at the backing knot as I picked the rod up. I've got it coming back now, but an absolute mental run. See now why at this range with so many rocks and obstructions between you and the fish, them double X hooks are really needed. Bit of thicker wire, you can afford to give the rod a little bit more. Everything on this session is stepped up to put up with the environment these fish live in. Tiny little common, I think, flying around. That is one arm-making long battle back to the bank.
Not little, dude.
And it turns out isn't that little.
Mid 30.
Pins and needles. Great thing about these quick-release swivels. No messing around. Just take the lead clip off. Get it out of the way. And that allows you to just deal with the fish nice and easily. 42. Yep, 42. Can't quite believe what's happening. Came here hoping and wishing for 140. We've just landed the sixth one.
Seventh.
It's absolutely a joke. Mental. Well, we'll give it an hour. Let it get light. We'll get them two out and have a proper look at them.
Well, there you have it. Instant results after the move. Move yesterday, first night in a new swim, 25 pound of torpedo common carp. They fight so hard in here. This one gave me the right run around. I'm gonna let this one go back now in the morning sun. I'm gonna get over and see Dave because he's got a brace of absolute belters.
Well, look at that one. Little bit of a different shape to the others I've had. A lot wider, a bit more of a brute. And to be fair, didn't really fight much. Come in a bit like a wet sack, this fish. But she's making up for it on the bank. I'm getting them out on that 6 metre spot. And then late in the night, they're rattling off. So everything is going to plan. Well, there you go, my 740 from Orellana, and what an absolutely beautiful fish. Little bit of a bent mouth on her, a few scales missing, so that'll be getting the pro care on it. But yeah, things couldn't be going better. I'm gonna get her back now, not mess her around, going out for a day's bass fishing, I believe. So really looking forward to that. We'll be right back.
Well, an opportunity has arisen for an adventure out in the boat for the afternoon. Dave, Jay and myself, we're going to do a spot of predator fishing.
Can't wait, mate. It's something I don't normally do at all. I'm a carp angler through and through. I haven't done really hardly any predator fishing, so I'm getting really excited for this. It should be fun.
Yeah, I've done a bit at home, but I'd love to see some bass, particularly a zander. Never caught one, so...
There's going to be a nice little catch to this predator adventure. Whoever catches the first one, they will get the first choice if we opt to move to a new area. So it's going to be nice, new surroundings, new piece of water to fish, and let's get going.
Great, let's do it, boys.
Cold, lads.
Yeah, I've got my big bear here to keep me warm.
Well, the weather's changed, mate, isn't it?
I thought it was sunny in Spain.
Joke, isn't it? Yeah. But I think with this weather and the way that the wind's pushing out of this bay now, I think it's about time that we got on our toes, didn't you?
We've had a great first few days, capitalised on some good fishing, especially you, Dave.
Yeah. I think definitely, lads, the fish have moved off. And we've got to do the same and go and find them.
Yeah, I think we started off this session, like with the prep before we got here, was all about travelling light, you know, the small bivvies, the small everything, wasn't it? Make it compact as we possibly can, so that when this happens, we get on our toes and move. And I genuinely believe next, you know, 12 hours, we'll get the night out of the way, pack up nice and early, and then we'll be off.
With a lake of this size, 31 miles in size, we've only really scratched the surface. We've only seen a small amount of it. We might get on our toes and find a lot of fish somewhere else. And
I'm looking forward to going to bed, getting warm.
Yeah, I know, it's freezing.
I wonder if there's a McDonald's on the other side of the lake.
The Golden Arches.
Absolutely insane storm. Thunder, lightning, the rain is mental. Can't even see down the lake now, the mountains. Proper big Spanish storm. Oh, here we go. I've got to go, I've got to retreat.
Well, it's been a quiet one, so we're on our toes. Whole plan was at the very beginning of this trip was to travel light, get as much gear left in the vans and stuff as we can, and it's paying off because we are on our toes.
Well, I'm just packing the gear away after the storm last night. I've had to drag the boat out and let it drain away,
we saw some serious rain. One of the Spanish lads who we spoke to yesterday told us about some fish about 2 miles away. So we're all packing up. This bay's gone quiet. We're going to get the gear in the boats. I'm going to head off probably about a mile and a half, 2 miles in the boats and try and find these carp.
But before that, Edwin's got to empty his boat of water. He's going to get over here. We had a big storm last night, so everything's soaking wet. But looks like the sun's going to break through that fog, dry everything out, and we'll be off maybe in the next hour or two.
Well, that's me 80% packed down. Gonna move for the second time to the third swim today. All I've got left to move is my bivvy, my bed, and 2 rods. What that means is one of the rods went last night, rewarded again by another small Spanish common. So all that's left to do now, bivvy, bed, 2 rods, check out this fish, get in the boats, and get to the new zone. Well, it's probably the smallest of the bunch so far for me and the lads, but he's more than welcome. It's going to be the last night in this swim. A huge storm came in last night. Absolutely ridiculous. Big bolts of lightning, loud claps of thunder, and the downpour for 4 or 5 hours was absolutely ridiculous. I'm going to slip this one back now, get on our toes, load the boats, and go and find a new spot. Thank you for making my acquaintance. Now go tell your granddad, I want it.
Turned out actually a really beautiful day, a nice breeze, lots of sunshine, which is perfect because after last night's storm I really do need some help drying this bivvy out because it's absolutely soaked. In 10 minutes it will be bone dry.
Well, I spoke a bit too soon there. On these large lakes the weather can change at the flick of a switch.
Jay got a hot swim on the corner, then Dan back a little bit. In truth be known, you know I let them win that fishing competition, didn't you? Of course. That's just the kind of guy I am.
First thing we noticed when we came into the new area is weed in an abundance. To the surface in many places, and where there's weed, there should be carp. So we're feeling quite confident, but the wind's got up and the big floating weed bed has come in and took one of the lines straight away. So I'm gonna clear the weed now and get the rod straight back out in position.
I've got third choice to swim, but I've got to say I'm not too unhappy with it. On the last swim we was in, I had a right result, so to get the sort of duffer, if you like, I'm quite happy. And I've not told the other guys, I've seen 6 fish since I've been here. So there's definitely carp out there, but there's a lot of weed to contend with. So it might be a few boat battles in this area.
Well, it wasn't long and a new swim gave me my first bite.
When you're fishing in weed and you've got to move in, you've got to keep them moving because you don't want them to get their head down. Once they get their head down, they'll bury you in it. But this is where braid comes into its own. There we go.
not going to keep her, but look, it's a double figure common. A lot of fuss to get a little fish in, but without that braid, I'm telling you, on nylon, you'd be going out in a boat now and maybe not even landing it. There you go. No good to man or beast, but it might do me some new hair.
With most of the bites coming during the night, I wasn't getting much sleep. Not that he's going to find me complaining.
There's a carp.
We was told that there was more fish in this area, but unfortunately I think it's a lot of small male fish. So I might have to do a little bit of wading. I don't know if the other guys are at anything, but I'll go back to the other area if they want. I think the camera crew would kill me if we mention a move, so I'm going back to bed.
With only two nights left to go, I wasn't slowing down. I wanted at least one more Orellana carp.
I can't believe I'm being trusted with the one bit of meat that could kill you. Yous are idiots.
These ain't far from me. Don't look at
the oil. What about a fork? There's a fork next to your foot, mate.
You give him a little... Get on my tits. That's Paul's. Oh, f*** me.
We might get some sausages, because at the minute, Jay's just chicken and juggling down here. What's the trick then, Dave? How can you...
How do we do it, Dave?
How do you determine getting bites... but catching all of them over £40 nearly.
Just boilies, mate. Golden balls.
Well, the same boilies, yeah. The same boilies that I've been putting in. Yeah. I'm getting 20 pounders.
You need golden balls. They work really well.
Incredible commons here, ain't they?
Oh, mate, some of them have been mad. Do you know, my favourite fish so far hasn't been the biggest one. It was that £33 mirror.
Yeah, I bet it was stunning, wasn't it?
Yeah, unbelievable. Like, all these little pearly scales and that.
Yeah.
I didn't expect to catch a mirror here.
I was going to say, to catch a mirror here, don't matter how big it is one, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
How about catching three then? It's been a great trip. Got a couple of days left. Anything could happen, that big one could turn up. Yeah, but yeah. It's great fishing with you boys again.
Absolutely, mate.
Health, happiness and big carp.
Cheers, Jack.
The great escape.
Great escape. Let's do it. Why does chicken take so long to cook? Why does that take half the time? Stupid.
That one's just laid an egg.
Do you know, there's been a few things that if any of my mates were coming here, I'd say they definitely need. And that was a double X hooks, because the weed's savage, isn't it?
Yeah.
And if it ain't savage, you've got the rocks. And the fish have got such hard mouths, I think them double X hooks have really made a difference.
Yeah.
What about you, Dan?
Probably the rotor blocks, like making sure you're getting out to the pinpoint accuracy, dropping your rig in the same position every time. Easy for baiting day and night.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd probably say rotor blocks.
I would say two, and that would be power packs and a toilet. Because genuinely, you are in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, you are.
Like, that you are. Like, even just to get to the road's 20 minute drive, you know, just to get to the main road. So for me, toilets, and because you're in the middle of nowhere, power packs. You need power to be on the bank. So.
Braided main line.
Yeah.
You have to fish strong here, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, if we start talking about tackle, then obviously you 100% need braid. I mean, we've got the new Descend out there, and it's absolutely bang on. Sinks. Goes a long way, innit? I mean, we're fishing at like, what, 300? Well, the other swim was 330 metres I was fishing.
Yeah, I was 450 yards.
Yeah, and that's all on one spool, so yeah. Absolutely perfect
I'm
for
really
that.
Happy. You know, like, after all the testing we did for that uni clip,
yeah.
it's just come out perfect.
Yeah.
Drop the lead instantly, whether you're using a 3-ounce lead or a 10-ounce lead, it's like ping, straight off, fish straight to the top, especially in this weed.
It will be the most innovative clip on the market.
Oh, 100%.
I know we say it because we're all with a brand and we're biased, but when you see the results of not dropping fish, the lead going every time, being in full contact, direct contact to the fish,
it
really will be a game changer for the fishing industry.
Would you come back?
I'd love to come back. Yeah. I would love to come back. I think like for me, this was my biggest fishing challenge and adventure, and I've got like the big carp buzz. Yeah. I feel like we've only scratched a small percentage of it.
No, you need 3 or 4 trips here to even get into it.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
But I have absolutely loved it.
Yeah.
Company's good, food's good, fishing's good.
Absolutely right. And the chicken is finished.
Yay! Hopefully Jay won't kill us.
That chicken's done, right?
With such a massive opportunity to fish this lake, I couldn't afford to take my foot off the gas, and I just kept working at it. With a carp stuck firmly in the weed, Dan helped me with my life jacket. I was just hoping she would still be there.
After a very quiet night, Dave's right-hand rod down towards the bay has absolutely burst into life.
Well, I was otherwise engaged, the number two engaged, and my rod's gone, and Dan's grabbed hold of it for me.
I've pulled up into it, got direct contact with the fish, held it for him. He's now out in the boat playing it. It's the first time we've had to go out in the boat playing any fish. The area that we're fishing is very, very weedy, so you've got to get directly above him in the boat. Makes it nice and easy to get the fish in. It looks like he's doing that very well at the moment. That's what happens in fishing. They sometimes get away. Looks like he's got all his tackle, so it's not going to be towing anything around. When you're fishing in such harsh weed like we're here now, that can happen. He's done everything he could, got above the fish, direct contact, but it has come off. I've just found out that Jay also lost one in the boat last night in the heavy weed. The weed that we're fishing here is very, very dense. So the lads are getting above him in the boats. Unfortunately, they've both come off. I believe they're going to get the rods back out now, gain a bit of morale, and we carry on going.
I'm not going to cry over spilt milk. Take a positive. There's still fish in the area. It was a late bite. I've got two rods on the same spot. So fingers crossed another one goes, but that's fishing. And I came here for a good old fashioned f***ing gunfight.
Well, I jokingly asked for a fight, and it was a fight that I got. With weed everywhere, everything really did end up in a big tangle, and it wasn't long before I had to take to the water and actually hand line the fish in. And this fish was not giving up easily.
So I had two rods quite close, and because of the weed dragging everything everywhere, the rod I thought originally had the fish on, it was the other rod. It's weeded me up. In the end, I've just got a big tangle and I've had to hand line it in. And as it shot off, the other hook's gone right in my thumb, but I managed to get it out quite quickly. I've been beaten up by a carp.
We've managed to nick one more fish. You enjoyed it, lads?
Mate, I've absolutely loved it. We came here with the expectation of catching a carp each. Yeah. We all did that. You absolutely smashed it. Danny boy, you did great. I struggled a little bit, but you know what? Spending time with you boys is what it's all about. And that's what the Great Escape originally was all about, is us three coming fishing and enjoying our time on the bank. So I've absolutely loved it.
It's been an absolute adventure. Spending time with these two has been absolutely great again. We've had all the sorts of weather that's been thrown at us. Big, heavy downpours, thunderstorms, glorious sunshine. and the backdrops, the scenery, the wildlife has just been phenomenal. Carp like this is what it's all about, the great escape.
Nothing else to say, brilliant.
Well done, mate, smash it.
Cheers. Come on,
boy.
Cheers,
let's get her back.
Dave said goodbye to another lovely Spanish common. Now, it wouldn't be the great escape without a challenge now, would it? What could be in store on a lake of this size? It was the unknown and we was absolutely bricking it.
Well, this is the usual.
Yeah, waiting for the text message to come through.
Hopefully it ain't some crappy eating challenge.
No, not again. Or water. I don't want anything to do with water.
No, I've had enough of water and eating. It's got to be something different.
I saw some notes and it said something like they was going to put us in a ball ring, but the ball was scared of Jay. And there was parachute. Then there was parachuting, but Dave's already broke his back in 12 places.
Yeah, you're not allowed ever to jump out of a plane ever again.
And banned.
Anything to do with fish and I couldn't even participate, so I wonder what this is going to be.
But I've got PTSD about getting in that little boat, so I definitely don't want to get into a bigger one with more waves.
Here we go. A ball fight?
Okay, so, Mr. Getty, Orellana Challenge, blood and guts. As always, you three say you sweat blood and guts for the company, which is true. Then we want you to put this into action. Three of you are challenged to try to take over the undercover headquarters, which will be heavily defended. Okay, the three of you will be equipped with three guns. Excellent. Travel SBS style to the far bank, where you will try to covertly take over headquarters. The first breach will join in the defence of headquarters, and this will show your commitment to the company. Winner wins, loser just loses. Sick got sicker. This is, hold on. No, well, we ain't shooting each other at least, because you've definitely got an advantage being in, like, actually being shooting.
No, someone will be, because whoever gets there first takes fire on the other two. So you help participate the people.
Oh, excellent. Yeah, you join the enemy.
If you all die, you die.
It's a good old fashioned gunfight.
I like it. Let's do this.
Let's go.
All good.
Right. See you. See you in the graveyard, yeah?
Let's go, boys!
With Danny Boy being the last one to make the building, there was only one thing for it. We had to kill him.
Well, that was exciting and exhilarating.
Do you know what? That was actually brilliant.
It was.
It makes me want to go home and start doing paintballing because that was a proper laugh. All that just freaking out.
Do you know what I liked about it? We've got to shoot the crap out of Paul.
Yeah.
All that stuff he's made
all
us eat on them
so
challenges.
Good.
I've had fish heads because of you.
Yeah.
When it went 4-on-1, I'm pretty sure they said, don't shoot him directly. You two is down the left-hand side and all my marks are down the left-hand side. So you two...
I even shot Jay a few times. He was running about and I thought, ruthless. Boom, they just shot and he went, ah! And he was looking
round.
That one. Like, yeah. It was great.
Yeah, it was a good challenge, that one.
Yeah, note to self, don't look down when you're about to get shot because I got caught right on the top of the head. I was nearly man down at one point.
You've actually got a lump.
I know.
A few beers, barbecue?
Yeah.
Let's do it. Let's go.
Sounds good.
I'll cook tonight, boys.
Nice one, mate.
With the last night upon us, the great Orellana blessed us with one more fish.
Really full, and probably the biggest one from this swim since we got it. So excellent. And if you needed any more less reason to not use a blowback rig, the hook hold on that. There we go. Just over 30 pounds. Excellent. It was nice. That's my last fish of this trip. £30. I'll take that all day long. I came here to catch a 40. I caught a 40. In fact, I caught several of them. Every one of the fish here has fought just as hard. It's been an absolutely amazing place. And it couldn't have been kinder to me.
Biggest fish from the second move, just over £30, and I can't tell you how much it means to me to do well on such a demanding venue. Amazing fish, they fight so hard because they've got 30 miles of water to swim up and down. They're like athletes, loving catching them. There you go, Lake Orellana Gold. One lake off the bucket list. Few more to go. Thank you, darling. Lake Orellana, what can I say? I've probably been waiting the best part of 2 years to come to this venue. 12,000 acres, 30 miles long, depths down to 100 feet, challenging. I knew it was going to push all of us to our limits, and it has.
It's been my first real taste of big water carp fishing abroad, and I've taken so much away from it. I've learnt loads and I've had a thoroughly enjoyable time.
It's about having fun and going home and wanting to rebook and come again, and that is what's happening here. I mean, I love this lake. The sunsets and the sunrises are fantastic. I'd come back just for those alone.
Beautiful surroundings, amazing sunsets, beautiful sunrises. So much I'm going to take away from this trip, and I really can't wait for the next one.
To have the week I've had on here, I feel absolutely blessed. Without a doubt, hands down, it's been my favourite ever Great Escape, the best venue. I just can't put into words how pleased I am. This is somewhere I will be coming back. This is the kind of place I feel I want to fish.
To all the haters, haters, those filled with jealousy, the naysayers, payers for defeat. Out of obstacles and stepping stones from roadblocks, skip over the lies that say we won't cross. We'll trick your hands like they're nothing. They won't see us coming. Scale all of the walls they built to hold us. We may be invisible, but we'll be unmistakable.
Girl, I'm just on a shoot.
Just on a shoot. Such a novel.
All right, I'll phone you back because I think you might be on the outtakes. I'll catch you in a little while. All right, in a bit. No, right.
All right, girl.
All right, girl.
Just chat for me, Doug.
I don't know what to say now.
There you go. Max, generator. Sounds like you got a ice cream van.
Then you simply off.
Just address. I meant the weight. Yeah, just reference the of these fish.
Sorry, I don't feel well. I'm gonna get back.
Look how long that is.
How big's that?
25.
Shut up.
Thank you for making my acquaintance. Now go tell your granddad I want it. And your big fat nana.
I just swallowed a fly. Won't need dinner tonight.
That could have been time or perfect.
Whoa, what is that with you? That's me! F***ing...
You get dirty fingers, you'll get a spot in there and it'll hurt like f***. I hate spots in those.
God, they're the worst, aren't they?
Oh.
Big as it.
You keep touching them.
Biggest zit I've ever had was in my nose.
Rolling.
Yeah, it's a huge.
I was just getting mozzies. Is that good to
having a wash in the lake.
Hope these fish like cheese.
Okay.